I don't know when we started going through the tunes. I think we spent about a year on it, meeting up every few weeks, playing through some tunes, talking about them, drinking lots of coffee, and really just having a little session and getting a feel for what the tunes are like and which ones we like, which ones we don't, how they might fit together, on what instruments, whether we maybe need to change the key of them for whatever reason. Learning about them, looking to see if they had any kind of a song text that we might be able to use, or concordances in other sources. Very, very painstaking, time-consuming, but really fascinating work.
My first contact with Confidences was in the late 70s, yes, and it was with people doing also traditional dances, and they were practicing these confidences also in England, working with people who had worked out of this Cecil Sharp school, I call it. So Cecil Sharp did a lot of collecting in England and then reconstructed all these dances.
Most research on playfoot and ballad tunes and country dances was done about 100 years ago in the first half of the 20th century. So much of my research involved trying to track down these very old articles, which often have really good information in them, and trawling through all of that to find out more about the tunes. We went through the first book.
Yes.
We decided to limit ourselves to the first book because I think there are 17 editions of Playfoot's Dancing Master. And we thought we'd just stick to the earliest one, the 1651 book, because presumably there we have the best chance of finding the earliest tunes, which we can then date back to the 16th century. If somebody asks you, what are the Playfoot tunes like? You can't really describe them, because there are Scottish tunes, there are Irish tunes, there are mask dances, there are ballads tunes, there are Spanish tunes, all kinds of things. And French tunes, we even had a French song in the programme. So it's really a melting pot of tunes from all kinds of different sources and backgrounds.
We had the idea we want to show a maximum of different constellations, because these country dances, they can be for two couples, for three couples, for four couples. The couples can be in long ways, in a line, they can be in a circle, they can be in a square. So all these possibilities we wanted to combine and to demonstrate. So it seems like dancing masters were accompanying themselves with the lute in the 16th century. And that's why we have also the dance treatises, giving the Italian treatises, giving the dance music as lute tablature first. And then they add, the later we come in the 16th century or just reaching 1600, they give a melody. And it becomes clear that more and more the melody will be played to accompany the dances, not an intabulation on the lute. And this is the evolution going to the violin, to the pochette, accompanying the dances.
The most likely accompaniment, instrumental accompaniment from that time would have been one instrument, probably yes. The violin, and we are four. I think it probably wasn't so typical to dance country dances to such a lavish ensemble as we had. On the other hand, we do know there are lots of references to country dances being danced before Queen Elizabeth I, for example. And I could imagine on those kind of special occasions, they may well have enhanced the solo violin with a few other instruments, especially with the lute, the cittern, the bass viol, the hurdy-gurdy, all instruments that we know were well used in England at the time and often played together.
For the project, we organized different groups of people participating. I organized a group of friends, dancers, students, ex-students, who prepared the more difficult country dances that we finally kind of demonstrated. And then I prepared people in a workshop, people from a dance class I have in Basel, and then we had people from the public who danced with us in the second performance. So we had this different approach or way of preparing and working.
I liked both concerts. I think we needed both concerts because, as you said, they're not stage dances and it's not stage music. It's music and dance to be performed together for our own pleasure. And that was really, for me, the big challenge in preparing the program was how to structure the program so that we could present this in a concert.
The second place, the Reithalle, manège, you say in French, is a beautiful place. It's a big, huge place. So we had enough space to have, I counted in one dance, we had 26 couples participating. So a lot of people, yeah, the right room for this kind of situation.
One of the tunes in Playford, we were able to track down as an old nursery rhyme, a kind of nonsense nursery rhyme called If All the World Were Paper. And we had the idea that to do this tune authentically, we really need to have some children involved in it. So I had my children come up and sing the tune with me. And I think that was also a good aspect of the whole event is that it does can involve children. It can be a family event.
Friars had no bald pates and nuns had no dark voices. If all the seas were...
They had this idea of making one paper plane. And during a dress rehearsal where they were not very quiet, I had a lot of paper. So I told them, let's make a lot of paper airplanes. So we also, it ended up being a paper folding workshop.
Folk players normally don't sit down with a book and decide, I'm going to learn this tune today. It's something which you learn over a long period of time, and especially if you grow up with folk music. You grow up with the tunes. You learn the tunes as you're growing over a long period of time until sometimes you don't even realize you've learned a tune. You've just heard it so often in a session. And this is a little bit the feeling we tried to replicate in our preparation work for this concert.
If you know generally country dances, you can very often jump in any one of them. And the important thing is to look at the people around you. And you see who looks at you, who gives you one hand or the other hand. And with the experience you have generally in that repertoire, you react. And you can be able to dance a country dance very just like this with other people without having practiced it. And then you see you're with people who all are smiling. They are all happy to meet each other, to do something that is challenging because of figures, but it's easy to do. It's easy and it's challenging. I think if you're aware of the others, then you can dance a country dance.